everyone. It is with great pleasure that I welcome all of you to the third MK Nambiar Endowment Lecture, where we have with us distinguished Professor Martha Nussbaum, who shall be speaking on disgust or equality, sexual orientation and Indian law. And joining us today for this lecture are esteemed dignitaries both in the audience and on the dais. And I welcome all of you to the third MK Nambiar Endowment Lecture. I now also take this opportunity to welcome Honorable Mr. Justice Altamush Kabir, former Chief Justice of India. Honorable Mrs. Justice Ruma Pal. Professor Martha Nussbaum. We thank all of you for taking out time for the lecture today, and I now request our respected Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor P. Ishwarabhan, to say a few words of welcome. Thank you.
Honorable Justice Kabir, Chairperson of today's endowment lecture. Honorable Justice Ruma Pal, moderator of third MK Nambiar endowment lecture. Dr. Martha Nussbaum, scholar who will be rendering a third endowment lecture. And all the faculty members, all the invitees, treasurer, Justice Talukdar, Kaushik Sir, Professor IGM, various academicians, invitees, students and friends. It gives me great pleasure in welcoming all of you to this third MK Nambiar lecture. Professor, MK Nambiar was a very eminent senior advocate of the Supreme Court. He joined the Mangalore Bar in 1921, then he moved over to London for his bar at law. He was from Lincoln's Inn. Then he handled some Privy Council cases at London. Then he joined Madras High Court. Subsequently, he moved over to Delhi, and he made up his career as a very erudite scholar in the field of constitutional law, and he argued very important cases. For example, cases like A.K. Gopalan's State of Madras, where his argument relating to interrelationship of fundamental rights was partly accepted. It was quite persuasive. The arguments were taken into consideration by at least a minority judge, Judge Fazal Ali. Of course, the majority also responded to certain extent. The concept of reasonableness was accepted, and it was only after 2 decades in a Maneka Gandhi case it was well accepted. About the presentation made by M.K. Nambiar in that case, it was viewed by one Mr. B. Sen in this way, that the entire courtroom seemed to be completely spellbound. There were no interruptions nor questions. The all-pervading silence broken only by Nambiar's voice and the rustling of the pages of the law reports. Soli Swaraji has his own appreciation about M.K. Nambiar. Inder Malhotra and various other advocates as well as attorneys had a lot of appreciation about M.K. Nambiar. His epoch-making arguments in I.C. Goloknath versus State of Punjab is still remembered because it contained the seeds of the new ideas, new concept of a basic structure. Perhaps for the first time in the world constitutional jurisprudence, that idea was initiated, and that became an acceptable proposition in a subsequent case, there's a Keshavananda. Although in I.C. Goloknath, basic structure theory was initiated, its full-fledged acceptance took place in Keshavananda case. It became one of the important principles in subsequent cases for a whole of judicial activism That was the trendsetter. Thus, he was a great advocate, and in his name, his son, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, constituted an endowment, and he also provided financial support for the travel of various scholars. First, we had very illustrious speech by Justice Michael Kirby, Australian High Court Judge. Then, in 2014, we had a brilliant lecture by Professor Mark Gallanter, and this is the third lecture. This is by Professor Martha Nussbaum. It was initially suggested that Mr. K.K. Venugopal will also be present, but he had to move to Kerala for attending some special occasion. Recently, he was endowed with the Padma Vibhushan. Earlier, he was awardee of Padma Bhushan, and this year he was a recipient of Padma Vibhushan. And in that contest, a felicitation function was organized in Kerala. So he had to attend that. He had sent special message for the occasion that will be read out in the course of the proceeding. Then on behalf of NUJS, on behalf of this endowment lecture, I am welcoming Honorable Justice Altamisu Kabir, former Chief Justice of India and presently Ford Foundation Chair Professor and Professor of Citizenship Studies. He has been a source of inspiration for all of us here, and he is presiding on behalf of NUJS. Let me heartily welcome Honorable Justice Altamisu Kabir. We thought of having a moderator. Justice Ruma Pala kindly agreed. As soon as we received consent from Martha Nussbaum, we approached Justice Ruma Pala long back, and she has kindly agreed to be moderator. She is a person with an illustrious career as a judge. After retirement in 2006, she is associated with NUJS. She was occupying Ford Foundation Human Rights Chair for 2 years. She was earlier appointed as a Supreme Court Judge in 2000. Earlier to that, in 1990, she was appointed as a Judge of Calcutta High Court. As a judge, she has rendered very important judgments relating to gender justice, empowerment of women, and various other aspects of social importance. Her contribution to the field of law can be visualized when we look to her latest edition to the book on Indian constitutional law, which was originally authored by Professor M.P. Jain. She is also Chancellor of Sikkim University. On behalf of NUJS, on behalf of this endowment lecture, I am heartily welcoming you, madam, to this audience. It's my pleasure to welcome Professor Martha Nussbaum. Martha Nussbaum is the first, is the Ernst Fund Distinguished Service Professor of Law and Ethics at the University of Chicago. She is a multidisciplinary scholar and serves in various departments at the University of Chicago. She studied at Harvard University and New York University, and has also taught at Harvard University, Brown University, and Oxford University. She has written and edited numerous books, some recent ones being Political Emotions, Why Love Matters for Justice, Harvard University Press, Creating Capabilities, The Human Development Approach, once again Harvard University Press, and The New Religious Intolerance, Overcoming the Politics of Fear in an Anxious Age, again Harvard University Press. She has a long association with India. at the United Nations University, where she worked with Amartya Sen to establish the human development or capabilities approach to the measurement of welfare. She was also a visiting professor of law at JNU and a consultant with the UNDP Delhi and a lawyers collective. Her well-known book, Women and Human Development, The Capabilities Approach, 2000, focuses on the struggle for gender equality in India. This month, her latest book, co-edited with Wendy Doniger, Pluralism and Democracy in India, Debating the Hindu Right, was released by Oxford University Press. She also delivered a John Locke lectures at the University of Oxford in 2014 on anger and forgiveness. Perhaps in the afternoon, she will be interacting with the faculty as well as the students on these crucial issues, anger and forgiveness. It is one of the most prestigious lectures on philosophy in the world. It is expected that the lectures will soon be published in the form of a book. Nussbaum has received more than 50 honorary degrees, numerous prizes and various awards. She is a leading scholar in multiple disciplines and is a pioneer in the advancement of the capabilities approach. When I had a talk with her yesterday, I came to know that she is a specialist in the field of philosophy, education, then law, as well as other disciplines like psychology. Nussbaum has received accolade from various corners. She is a leading scholar. Of course, her books include The Fragility of Goodness, Luck and Ethics, then Therapy of Desire, then Poetic Justice for Love and for Love of Country, Cultivating Humanity, How Humanity is Important for Studying Law. About that, she has intensively researched. Human and Women Development, 2000, Upheavals of Thought, The Intelligence of Emotions, Hiding from Humanity, Disgust, Shame and Law, Frontiers of Justice, Disability, Nationality, Species Membership, then The Clash Within. For want of time, I will not be able to read the names of all the books. She has authored more than 30 books. She has authored a number of articles. Perhaps each year she has produced one book and more than one article. It's a privilege to have a scholar like Professor Martha Nussbaum here on behalf of West Bengal National University of Judicial Science, on behalf of this endometer lecture. Let me extend a very hearty welcome to Professor Martha Nussbaum. Excitement to hear to the lecture by Professor Martha Nussbaum, in spite of the examination that is scheduled day after tomorrow. Many of the students, most of the students are present, and it's quite a happy thing that there is a good audience from all sections. With this, let me conclude. Let me welcome again all of you to this August function. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We now have a message by Sri K.K. Venugopal, and I request Mr. Vasujit Ram to please read it out for the benefit of this August gathering.
This is the message given by Senior Advocate Sri K.K. Venugopal. I quote, I thank the National University of Juridical Sciences for organizing this third M.K. Nambiar Endowment Lecture in honor of my father, the late Sri M.K. Nambiar. First of all, let me offer my sincere apologies for being unable to be physically present with you on this occasion, as I am being felicitated by the Bar Council of India and the State Bar Councils at its national meet in Kovalam, Kerala, for being awarded the Padma Vibhushan, and therefore it has been proven impossible for me to travel to Kolkata in time for this occasion. The receipt of the Padma Vibhushan has been both an immensely satisfying and humbling experience, and the journey began undoubtedly because of one person alone, my father, Sri M.K. Nambiar, who was responsible for my becoming a lawyer. At the full court reference held for my father upon his passing, Chief Justice A.M. Ray said, "He belonged to that school of lawyers who are guided by dignity and discipline in professional life. He was a lawyer whose arguments struck the balance between rigidity on one hand and formalness on the other." The late Justice Krishna Iyer too said, referring to the first great constitutional case argued in the Supreme Court of India, "There was a commitment about him in the garb of fundamental rights. He fought the case not for the ideology of his client, who was a communist, but for the ideology of human rights, which found expression in Part 3. His complete commitment to the human cause. I consider it extremely apt, therefore, that this year's M.K. Nambiar lecture will be delivered by none other than the formidable defender of liberal values, Professor Nussbaum. Her scholarship on a variety of topics from constitutional law to feminist jurisprudence to developmental economics and moral ethics has formed part of the bedrock of international debate in each of these areas. She has rightly been hailed as America's most prominent philosopher of public life. I am sure the audience is in for an enriching experience, and I myself deeply regret being unable to be here." Thank you.
I now request Honorable Mrs. Justice Ruma Pal to kindly say a few words and request Madam Nussbaum to start with the lecture. Thank you.
I had decided and I agreed with a great deal of eagerness when the Vice Chancellor asked me to come to this function. I said in whatever capacity I would come, because I was very eager to hear Professor Nussbaum and her views, particularly in the way she presents her views and her analytical approach to various issues which society confronts and which certainly have come up for decision for this the courts in India. So may I request Professor Nussbaum, without any further ado, to
say. First of all, I want to express warm thanks to Vice Chancellor Bhatt for inviting me to give this memorial lecture. And also thanks to Mrs. Justice Ruma Pal and to Justice Mr. Justice Altimos Kabir for being present and really giving me the honor of your presence. And thank you all for coming just before your exams. That's quite striking and remarkable. So I'm going to talk about an issue that I think it's ongoing and it's of urgent social relevance. The landscape of same-sex law around the world has been changing rapidly. In the United States, although sodomy laws were not thrown out until 2003, it now seems likely that within a very few months, same-sex marriage will be our national norm. In India, despite the decriminalization of sodomy in 2009, the criminal statute has been reinstated by the Supreme Court. Each country, in short, has its own story. Because of my long-standing focus as a legal scholar on Indian constitutional law as well as on US law, I'm delighted by the opportunity to assess the Indian developments several years after having published a book on sexual orientation and constitutional law in the United States. I've long argued as a legal theorist for a theory of stigma and group discrimination that makes the operations of the emotion of disgust central. I developed this theory in the book Hiding from Humanity, 2004, using results in cognitive psychology to show how disgust operates in a wide range of types of discrimination, including anti-Semitism, racism, sexism, homophobia, and discrimination against people with disabilities. I then made the normative argument that disgust is never a sufficient condition to make an act illegal when it causes no harm to non-consenting parties. That general argument had been made by the great British legal philosopher Herbert Hart, responding to the conservative jurist Lord Devlin, who opposed the decriminalization of sodomy in the 1960s, saying that the disgust of the average member of society was a sufficient condition to make an act illegal, even if it caused no harm to others. Their debate continued the 19th century exchange between conservative James Fitzjames Stephen and liberal John Stuart Mill. But I argued that a close analysis of the particular cognitive structure of disgust, which none of these theorists had attempted, was crucial to understanding just why it was so unsuitable as a basis for law. In 2010, in my book From Disgust to Humanity, Sexual Orientation and Constitutional Law, I developed the theory further and then connected it empirically to recent discrimination against gays and lesbians in the US. I suggested that the legal notion of animus used in both Lawrence against Texas, invalidating the sodomy laws, and the earlier Romer versus Evans, invalidating a law that prevented gays and lesbians from getting protection from anti-discrimination laws, was best understood as an allusion to disgust above all. And I tried to show how my theory supported the decisions and the reasoning in those two cases. I also argued that despite the surface absence of disgust from arguments against same-sex marriage, disgust was actually a driving force, as with earlier opposition to interracial marriage. I supported this claim by a study of the pamphlet literature that had circulated at the time in which appeals to disgust were prominent. Now here, I propose first to recap my theory of disgust and then to turn to the recent developments in India, where much of my work as a political theorist has actually taken place. These cases are not only fascinating and of urgent human significance, they're also theoretically significant, and I think they do confirm and further develop a disgust-based theory. Because India is a common law country with a written constitution containing an enumerated list of fundamental rights, it's easy to compare to the United States, as was in fact the intention of Ambedkar, who believed that vulnerable groups needed explicit protection from majority tyranny. Knowing what majorities were capable of through a childhood of appalling discrimination and brutality, Ambedkar insisted on a Bill of Rights that could not be trumped by majority sentiment, and his views continue to play a central role in the recent debate. We'll see that what's precisely at issue in the recent struggle over same-sex rights is the tension between fundamental rights and majoritarianism when community disgust enters the picture. When I hear about struggles over these issues as an American, I think immediately also of our continuing struggle against racism and racial segregation. And this is not wrong. It's that denial of basic equality and dignity, inspired by bodily loathing and irrational fears of contamination, that Ambedkar set out to stymie by ensuring that the Constitution had a strong and explicit commitment to fundamental rights and equal protection, even when majority sentiment was beastly, as it was. Now, as we'll see, the memory and the recent, and to a distressing extent current, reality of the horrible caste practices that were central to his thinking informs the reasoning of Indian courts concerning same-sex law, just as an analogy to laws against interracial marriage, which were only thrown out in the US in 1967, often informs the treatment of sexual orientation in US law. So first then, disgust and law. So let me summarize my theory of disgust, drawing on the research of Paul Rosen and a great team of first-rate psychologists. All human beings appear to share an acute discomfort when confronted by their own bodily fluids, excretions, and smells, and by the decay of the corpse. I use the term primary disgust for a shrinking from contamination by such objects and by other objects that closely resemble them in smell or feel, such as insects and animals that are slimy and smelly and so forth. Primary disgust, though not present at birth, is probably evolutionarily programmed, and it is certainly culturally universal, although this aversive reaction may in some cases protect people from real danger, and perhaps that was its evolutionary origin. Paul Rosen shows in great experiments that its cognitive content is quite different from that of fear. It's about contamination, not danger. It's a reaction to the animality and decay of the human body, and it's both under-inclusive and over-inclusive for real danger. Many dangerous things are not disgusting, and people feel disgust even when they're rationally convinced that all danger is absent. Rosen concludes that when we feel disgust, we're rejecting something about our own animality. All that might be harmless enough, although I would argue that it's always problematic to encourage this sort of self-loathing. In all known societies, however, people do not stop there, and now we arrive at what I call projective disgust. People seek to create a kind of buffer zone between themselves and their own animality by identifying a group, usually a powerless minority, who can be targeted as the quasi-animals, and projecting onto that group various animal characteristics which they have to no greater degree than any other human beings, that is smell, animal sexuality, and so on. The so-called thinking seems to be, if those quasi-animals stand between us and our animal stench and decay, we, the dominant group, are that much further from being animal and mortal ourselves. There is no known human society in which we do not find subgroups to whom irrationally properties of smelliness, hypersexuality, and in general, hyperanimality are imputed. There are many different varieties of disgust stigma. In European anti-Semitism, Jews were depicted as hyperbodily, hypersexual, and smelly, but also as crafty and intelligent. African Americans, by contrast, in United States racism, were, and unfortunately at times still are, imagined as hypersexual and also smelly, bestial, and stupid. Again, African Americans are imagined as physically powerful and aggressive. To upper Hindu castes who observed untouchability, untouchables were foul and contaminating, but weak and not particularly aggressive. These differences are very important, and yet a certain set of common threads runs through all. What about the propaganda that links disgust with same-sex acts? I studied a lot of the US pamphlet literature that attempts to whip up animosity toward gays and lesbians, though above all toward gay men, and found prominent use of the tropes of projective disgust. The standard way of doing this is to focus obsessively on anal sex and to describe it in terms apt to elicit revulsion. All sorts of abstract claims are made, such as the claim that gays eat feces and drink raw blood. And I actually heard Will Perkins, who was the proponent of Colorado's Amendment 2, the law that was thrown out in Romer versus Evans, I heard him testify under oath in a Denver, Colorado courtroom in the bench trial of Evans versus Romer that he had circulated pamphlets that made that claim. A related trope is the idea that gays travel a lot and thus bring germs into America. Fascinatingly reminiscent of Nazi propaganda linking Jews to a variety of diseases. India, as we'll see, has related problems. Projective disgust always leads to some type of avoidance of bodily contact. But again, the type and extent vary. African Americans were forbidden to use white people's drinking fountains, swimming pools, lunch counters, hotel beds, and of course, sexual contact was strictly forbidden and a felony, a very serious crime in many states. Widely, though, white men always had sexual relationships with and sexually abused black women. And yet, an African American might prepare and serve food for a white family. An Indian Dalit, by contrast, could not serve food in an upper caste family. And as I said, Dalits also could not share lodging or drinking taps. The crazy irrationalities of these ideas are manifold. As for gay men in America, given the reality of the closet, no ban on shared restaurants, lodgings, drinking fountains, or even swimming pools could realistically be imposed. But the desire to impose one crops up in strange places, such as the symbolic aversion to shared showers in the military. And that's one of the main issues raised in the question of whether gays could serve in the armed forces. I say symbolic because it's well known that all gyms have a fairly high proportion of gay and lesbian members, and yet I know of no attempt to oust gays from the locker room, which of course would be both impossible and very bad for business. Still, straight men often fantasize that the very gaze of a gay man in the shower could penetrate and thus sully them. Where they could use this to exclude gays, they did. Now to law. My general normative conclusion was that close study of the operations of disgust should give us reasons not to base laws upon it at all, even should we remain skeptical of John Stuart Mill's argument that harm to the non-consenting is a necessary condition for the legal regulation of conduct. Of course, I agree with Mill, but I think we can give new support to many of his positions by the study of disgust. But now to India. To set the stage for the current legal struggle, I have to discuss its background in Hinduism, since it's there and not in India's minority religious communities that struggle over purity and disgust rages, although, as we'll see, it gets a lot of help from British Victorian Christianity. I'm sure all of you know this history, but it seems useful to summarize it nonetheless. Among all the world's major religions, Hinduism is the one that most unequivocally celebrates the body and its pleasures. Sexuality has a central and a positive place. Thus, the three arts that one must know in order to live well are the art of morality, dharma, the art of political economic management, artha, and the art of pleasure, kama. To each of these arts is devoted a major religious text. Westerners think the Kama Sutra is a type of pornography, but it's actually as solemn as the other two key religious texts. Nor is the sexuality that is celebrated there a narrow type. There's great variety, women are encouraged to take sexual initiative, and same-sex acts are often celebrated without stigma. The ancient epics are somewhat more judgmental, but they too give many examples of the gods and heroes having a wide range of desires and relationships. Traditionally too, hijras, transgender men who have sex as women, were not stigmatized, but were regarded as auspicious. Since that community plays an important role in recent litigation, I'm going to say more about that later. On the other hand, Hinduism of a later period ossified into a form in which some bodily functions are heavily stigmatized. As the caste hierarchy developed out of the earlier system of the four varnas, the idea of untouchability became extremely prominent. Untouchability was closely connected with disgust at feces and corpses, and attached above all to those whose occupations connected them to those matters. A whole ideology of disgust developed, and of course it was thought to be contaminating to share anything with such people. Untouchability focused on feces and decay, and for some time it coexisted with celebration of sexual pleasure. But stigma also began to attach increasingly to non-marital sexuality and to some degree to sexuality itself. This development, already suggested in some traditional texts, was greatly egged on by Victorian British Puritanism. The British had a horror of India's sexual freedom. Clearly, they had a fascination too, and an earlier era saw a lot of interrelationship. But as the Victorian era arrived, the British in India connected their Puritanism to a new shrinking from the overt sexuality and sensuousness of the way they viewed Indian religion. The received British view was that the Hindu religion was filthy. Typical and giving authority to that view was Winston Churchill, who said in 1942, quote, "I hate Indians. They're a beastly people with a beastly religion." As time went on, reacting to this affront, some Hindus began to internalize the Victorian critique and to ape Victorian Puritanism in order to deflect criticism. They emphasized sexual purity more and more, along with the traditional strictures attached to caste. Thus, Hindus struggled with the body, becoming increasingly anxious about representations of joyful and sensuous bodily life. Some progressive leaders, and of course Gandhi led the way, crusaded vehemently against untouchability, and Gandhi was famous for insisting that his followers perform tasks that were traditionally performed only by Dalits, such as cleaning latrines, so combating disgust on that front. But Gandhi never fully accepted the political equality of Dalits, as is becoming increasingly clear in new research, and he also combined his progressivism with a famous emphasis on dietary and sexual purity that, while it surely had some Hindu roots, was in many respects extremely alien. Gandhi always counted Tolstoy as among his key intellectual influences, and he had by then spent many years in Christian circles. Far from urging that all people accept their bodily nature and learn not to feel disgust at their bodily functions, he expressed a powerful loathing of sexuality in all its forms, sought to extirpate it in himself, and expressed in harsh terms his moral judgment on the sexual lives of others. Gandhi loathed all sexual acts, but same-sex acts came in a way, for particular emphasis. Perhaps because, unlike opposite-sex acts, they didn't even have the redeeming virtue of procreation. Once, a student of Rabindranath Tagore asked Gandhi what he thought of the role of the arts in society. And Gandhi immediately said, "Artists can be highly immoral. Look at Oscar Wilde." Now, the fact that Oscar Wilde, who of course famously went to prison for same-sex conduct, was the first example of an artist that came to his mind seems really very significant. So Gandhi, while asking his followers to repudiate bodily disgust in one area, caste, ramped it up in another, sex, and he created a Puritanism that in some respects reinforced the Victorian critique. Disgust also had its determined opponents. Again, I'm sure you all know this, but I've written extensively about Tagore, and I love to talk about him, so I will. Rabindranath Tagore, the great poet, novelist, philosopher, composer, choreographer, dancer, and educator, held the view that free and equal citizenship in the nation of the future required finding joy and pride in the human body, and he set about creating a style of education for the young in his school at Shantiniketan that aimed at bodily reconciliation and love. Students learned in large part through dance and music, led by the example of Tagore himself, a superb dancer whose techniques as both dancer and choreographer were studied by dance leaders all over the world. The message Tagore continually sent, though still in a very reticent and carefully controlled way, was that there can be no political freedom without bodily freedom and acceptance. His own style of dance, in the many surviving photographs and accounts, and I think especially of Amita Sen's wonderful book, Joy in All Work, was androgynous and sensuously receptive rather than aggressive. In Tagore's major philosophical work, The Religion of Man, he ventures yet further into anti-Victorian terrain by citing as his prototype of the sort of love a good society needs at its heart, the bowels of Bengal. And he gives the example further emphasis by appending to the book a learned and, you know, still highly reticent, but still quite correct, essay on the bowels by K.M. Sen, the great scholar of Hinduism, who was also Amartya Sen's maternal grandfather and Amita Sen's father. The bowels, of course, are countercultural minstrels who have left organized society to form their own marginal society based upon both bodily and emotional love. Although Tagore does not go into explicit detail for his British audience, I mean, these were lectures delivered in Britain, they were well known to have countercultural sexual practices, both opposite sex and same sex, and to have initiation rituals that required the aspirant to taste all the fluids of the body, thus repudiating disgust. Their creed was, and still is, love of humanity, and they believe that this love requires forming a loving relationship with all the parts and fluids of the body. Tagore's own poetry and musical compositions are closely inspired by vowel lyrics, and one of his most famous dance dramas was Rituranga, in which he himself danced the role of the blind vowel who breaks the fetters of tradition with which an uncomprehending society has shackled him. Here's Amita Sen's description of that performance. Entering the stage, he sang as he walked, "My fetters will be broken. At the time of departure, I am free. Who can imprison me behind locked doors? I go into the dark as the evening bell rings." And then she says, "What a wonderful movement of strong hands, breaking fetters. The free wayfarer advances, the joy of freedom ringing in his steps and fearlessness in his clear voice. Even after he had left the stage, the sound of the evening bell echoed in the spectators' ears." So here a young woman, I mean, she was around 12 years old when she saw that performance, sees in Tagore's body a powerful image of citizenship in the not yet created Indian nation of the future. The image is drawn from, at any rate, a sexual counterculture. Tagore, moreover, closely connected the struggle against sexual disgust with the struggle against caste and race-based disgust. In his great novel, Gora, the young hero, whose name of course means pale face, decides that a rededication to traditional caste norms is the core of a renewed Hinduism and the best basis for Indian citizenship in the future nation. Gora, accordingly, refuses food that his own mother has prepared because she's not willing to ostracize a Christian maidservant who cooks for the family. Of course, Christians in that region who are often converts from the lowest castes, so the idea of untouchability, not just Christianity, is clearly operative. But the reader knows early on that Gora's project is doomed because, as his name suggests, he's actually not a Hindu at all, but the adopted child of an Irish mother who died in 1857 during the First War of Independence. His mother's liberal attitudes led her to adopt this baby and bring it up as her own. By the end of the novel, Gora has realized that the new nation must be based on the repudiation of caste disgust and a related repudiation of disgust-based misogyny, and in short, the embrace of humanity in all people. Where are same-sex relationships in Tagore? In many ways, he seems to be a spiritual cousin of the American poet Walt Whitman, and he does gesture toward the conclusion that India must also accept same-sex relationships, even as it accepts the equality of all castes and the equality of women. This message is sent pretty clearly, since the Bowels do practice same-sex conduct, but he certainly never makes the idea explicit, and he really couldn't at the time. Nor, of course, did he himself have any such relationships. He really didn't have, in his adult life, sexual relationships at all. But his style of dance does return to the older androgynous and sensuous idea of Hindu masculinity, part and parcel of which, originally, was openness to receptive sexuality and perhaps to same-sex desire. Today's India, in some quarters anyway, has forgotten the joyful message of inclusion sent by Tagore. There's a lot of Puritanism, and it targets both women's freedom and same-sex relationships. The Hindu right has been around since the turn of the century, but it now continues the post-Victorian emphasis on bodily purity. It has campaigned ceaselessly for years against the scholarly portrayal of Hinduism as a religion that prominently includes sensuousness, sexual variety, and bodily delight. Many books have been targeted under a law that makes it a crime to outrage the feelings of Hindus, but especially virulent has been the well-known assault on my colleague Wendy Doniger, the great historian of Hindu religion, for her two recent books portraying in a very positive light the sexual aspects of early Hindu religion. Indeed, the lawsuit against Doniger's book, The Hindus, makes it clear that one of the main objections is to the zest and humor with which Doniger portrays the sexuality of the gods and heroes. The plaintiff, Dinanath Batra, a proud member of the RSS, describes Doniger in the brief itself as, quote, "a woman hungry of sex," end quote. although the lawsuit legally was ludicrously weak and the case eminently winnable, Penguin India, fearing violence against its employees, agreed to settle and get rid of all copies of the book. As for same-sex relations, a recent Gandhi biography by Joseph Lelleveld was banned in Gujarat and was denounced by Modi and other leading Hindu right politicians, none of whom seems to have read it. They believe that it imputed homosexuality to Gandhi, where in fact it does not. But anyway, a national ban was considered, but the law minister decided not to go ahead, perhaps because he had discovered by actually reading the book that Lelleveld had not actually imputed homosexuality to Gandhi. So there's a sex panic at large in some parts of the nation, and as we'll see shortly, the Victorian past and the current Hindu right-wing present are once again joining hands to oppress and stigmatize. So now to section 377 and the legal struggle. The British believed that they could govern best if both commercial law and criminal law were uniform for all of India, while they strongly encouraged civil law to be managed by the four major religions. This setup, in many ways, continues. Thus, the criminal law of India was written in the Victorian era and rarely updated, and not surprisingly, it's British and not particularly Indian. It contains some odd British artifacts, for example, the remedy of restitution of conjugal rights, which makes sense really only in the context of 19th century British divorce litigation. It also contains the criminal offense of, quote, outraging the modesty of a woman, end quote, which has been a very uneasy fulcrum for Indian feminists seeking redress against sexual harassment. It's proven divisive, advantaging so-called modest women of upper class and disadvantaging those who are thought not to have modesty in the first place, for example, because they perform manual labor. Modesty was even defined in a 1998 Supreme Court case via several British dictionaries as, quote, womanly propriety of behavior, scrupulous chastity of thought, speech, and conduct, end quote. These Victorian ideas are not very helpful if what is wanted is women's equality. And of course, the culture that was historically Europe's most intensely homophobic, the culture that sentenced Oscar Wilde to 3 years at hard labor for oral sex with consenting partners, did not hesitate to insert its strictures on same-sex acts into the Indian criminal law as well. So section 377 of the Indian Penal Code reads as follows. Unnatural offenses. Whoever voluntarily has carnal intercourse against the order of nature with any man, woman, or animal shall be punished with imprisonment for life or with imprisonment of either description for term, which may extend to 10 years, and shall also be liable to fine. Explanation: penetration is sufficient to constitute the carnal intercourse necessary to the offense described in this section. Now, even more than my other examples, this law bears the unmistakable stamp of antiquated Victorian piety. It's crystal clear that this law is quite foreign to India. The idea of the order of nature and of certain sex acts as offenses against that order is utterly Western and Christian in origin, with no foundation in non-Christian Indian traditions, as subsequent legal arguments rightly insist. Nor do non-Christian Indian traditions seek the legal regulation of same-sex conduct. India, indeed, was long a haven for British gay men seeking a greater liberty. The novelist E.M. Forster is just one example of those British men. This is not to say that Indian society in the 20th century has been tolerant of same-sex conduct. It has not, and I've suggested that the reasons for this derive in part from the pain of British stigmatization and critique and the desire of elites to emulate Victorian propriety, although they derive no doubt as well from some aspects or versions of indigenous traditions. But it is to say that the law itself, with all its Christian framing, is a very problematic one for any court in independent India to uphold. Moreover, like many sodomy laws in the United States, it's both under and over-inclusive so far as same-sex conduct is concerned. It apparently applies to opposite-sex anal penetration as well as to same-sex, and it really doesn't say anything very clear about oral sex or mutual masturbation. Case law has already been grappling with those problems. It was long felt that Section 377 was an anachronism, and by late in the 20th century, pressure began building to seek its repeal. The campaign gained momentum from the battle against HIV/AIDS. Groups grappling with the disease understood that criminal laws against gay sex were a strong deterrent to seeking testing, counseling, and treatment. Even many who had no particular sympathy with the lesbian and gay community sought the repeal as a clear public health issue. Part of the repeal strategy was protest, as a variety of intellectuals, activists, and literary figures spoke up against the law. Another arm was a legal challenge to the law's constitutionality. The NAS Foundation, an activist group working with same-sex issues, joined forces with the Lawyers Collective, a very famous and prestigious legal NGO. Founded by Indira Jaisingh and her husband Anand Grover, the collective has two arms, one dealing with women's equality and the other with HIV/AIDS. Jaisingh's distinction as a lawyer led to her appointment as the first woman assistant solicitor general under the recent Congress government, as well as many other recognitions. Meanwhile, Grover's distinction was recognized worldwide when he was named Special Rapporteur for HIV/AIDS by the United Nations. So the case found a prestigious team of advocates. The challenge to Section 377 was initially filed in 2001, but in 2003, the Delhi High Court refused to consider it, concluding that the petitioners lacked standing because the law was rarely enforced. Petitioners appealed to the Supreme Court to reinstate the case, and the court agreed, sending it back to the Delhi High Court to consider it on its merits. The case was finally considered in 2008. The government was divided, as the High Court later said, quote, a rather peculiar feature of this case, end quote. The health ministry supported the petitioners on the ground that Section 377 was counterproductive in the fight against HIV/AIDS. The home ministry supported the law. And the new law minister, the same man who had who later refused to ban Lilavel's Gandhi book because he actually read it, conceded that the law was probably outdated. In July 2009, the Delhi High Court struck down Section 377, holding that it violates Article 14 of the Fundamental Rights section of the Indian Constitution, which guarantees all citizens equality before the laws and equal protection of the laws, as well as Article 15, non-discrimination, and centrally, 21, right to life with dignity and a right of privacy, as we'll see. The case was heard by two of the High Court's most respected judges, Justice A.P. Shah and Justice Muralidhar, both known for the quality and the progressive character of their opinions. The NAS Foundation opinion is very long and unusually complex, given the number of distinct legal and factual issues involved. Because the later reversal fails to confront these arguments, I have to lay them out now. In general, what's particularly impressive about the opinion is its thoroughness. It cites many social science findings and a huge number of legal judgments, both from Indian courts and from courts abroad, as well as a wide range of international documents. This aspect of the opinion can't really be reproduced here. The opinion's over 100 pages long, but you should imagine it. But a succinct summary of its major arguments is now going to be attempted. Throughout the opinion, the acronym MSM, men who have sex with men, is used, thus bypassing irrelevant questions about whether we're talking about acts or orientations. The opinion is written as if the targeted group is entirely male, and nothing at all is said about lesbians or whether Section 377 has ever been used to burden their rights. In Britain, in fact, lesbian acts were never illegal, and maybe that's the reason why they feel they can ignore that. So I'll follow the logic of the opinion, but I do note that narrowness. First, history. The court repeatedly delves into the history of Section 377, insisting, as I already have, that its foundation is Victorian and Christian with no basis in Indian traditions. Because India was more liberal than Britain in matters of sexual orientation, the court notes, many people came to India to take advantage of that liberal atmosphere. Therefore, in 1960, when Lord Macaulay drafted the Indian Penal Code, he felt a need to be harsh, introducing this idea of offenses against the order of nature. But that was a Western concept, quote, based on a conception of sexual morality specific to the Victorian era drawing on notions of carnality and sinfulness, end quote. At this point, the court cites an Australian opinion by the distinguished Justice Michael Kirby, one of my predecessors giving this memorial lecture, noting that a similar law in Australia was, quote, imposed on colonial people, end quote. This history is not legally relevant without further argument, but it does prepare the reader to see a dissonance between India's own self-imposed constitution and the vestiges of empire that remain in the penal code. As the Nas, the court says, quote, there is no presumption of constitutionality of colonial legislation, end quote. Next, facts. Since the Supreme Court will subsequently overrule the Delhi High Court on the findings of fact, an unusual thing for a higher court to do, we might expect to see sloppiness in the factual record. Nothing could be further from the truth. Buttressing its argument with wide-ranging citations from empirical and scientific studies, some of which were made available to the court in amicus briefs, and some of which it apparently found on its own, the court draws three important conclusions. Number one, the illegality of consensual same-sex acts harms public health to efforts to curb the spread of HIV/AIDS by discouraging MSM from seeking treatment and testing. This is the primary emphasis of the factual argument, and detailed factual analysis was presented to the court in an affidavit from the National AIDS Control Organization, affirmed by the government's Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Further data were presented in an amicus brief from the Lawyers Collective. The court notes an opposing argument by the Home Office to the effect that criminalizing gay sex will help the struggle against HIV/AIDS by deterring homosexual acts, but it concludes correctly that there's no evidence supporting that contention and a great deal of evidence against it. Second, the illegality of same-sex acts has led to violence against gay men, including violence by the police. This section of the opinion draws on a wide range of affidavits involving gang rape, police violence, custodial torture, and other offenses. Three, the illegality of same-sex acts is associated with feelings of low self-esteem and humiliation. This argument, buttressed by psychological studies from many nations, lies on the border of fact and norm, but the fact of such feelings will later prove relevant in reaching the normative conclusion that dignity has been violated, so I include it here. So now to constitutional argument. The court makes three constitutional arguments. I'll begin with two briefer arguments that actually occur later in the opinion in order to dwell on the pivotal Article 21 argument. Addressing Article 14, equality before the law, the court reviews the history of the requirement that a law's classification must be founded upon an intelligible differentia and one that has a rational relation to the objectives of the law. Arbitrariness is excluded, as is an objective that is itself, quote, illogical, unfair, and unjust, end quote. But, argues the court, Section 377 does not take account of relevant factors such as consent, and its classification is based upon, quote, disgust toward a particular social group or animus. Its classification is therefore, quote, both arbitrary and unreasonable. As to Article 15, discrimination, what needs to be argued is that discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation amounts to discrimination on the basis of sex, since sex and not sexual orientation is mentioned in the constitutional text. The view that sexual orientation discrimination is a form of discrimination on the basis of sex has frequently been urged in the legal academic literature. After all, to criminalize a consensual act because its participants are two men rather than a man and a woman is in the most straightforward sense to discriminate on the basis of sex. U.S. courts have, however, been rather reluctant to accept this argument. Some state courts have accepted it, but the U.S. Supreme Court never has. However, here, the Delhi High Court does accept it. The court mentions that the Canadian Supreme Court agrees, but they then proceed to offer an independent argument for the conclusion. First, they say, a primary purpose of anti-discrimination norms is to prevent individuals from being judged by gender stereotypes, but that's exactly what Section 377 does. Furthermore, a series of prior cases dealing with discrimination against women contain language implying that all cases dealing with gender stereotypes must be subject to strict scrutiny, which Section 377 will not pass, as we'll see. Now, Article 21 provided the court with its central line of argument. The basic idea is that if it is established that a law burdens a fundamental right, the law can only survive if the state can demonstrate a compelling governmental interest. This basic tenet of Indian constitutional law was set forth very clearly in a series of cases that the court extensively cites. There are two fundamental rights at stake, the right to privacy and the closely related right to life with dignity. Much is said about the intimate relationship between privacy, especially sexual privacy, and full human dignity. These rights are not explicit in the constitutional text, but they had already been recognized over the years through interpretation of Article 21. Now, I have to provide some history, as the opinion does also at this point, since Article 21, as written, says only, quote, no person may be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law, end quote. No mention of privacy and none of dignity. At the time of the framing, India deliberately sought to limit due process to the procedural, since Ambedkar had learned from his study of US history that substantive due process, as in our Lochner era, could be used against laws friendly to labor. So in place of the words due process of law, which occur in our Constitution's 14th Amendment, the document reads only procedure established by law. However, as time went on, the need for substantive due process began to be felt in three areas. Limits on police behavior, since India's Constitution lacks an analog of the US Constitution's 4th Amendment banning unreasonable searches and seizures. Second, limits on criminal punishment, since it also lacks a direct analog of our 8th Amendment limiting cruel or unusual punishments. And finally, sexual privacy. India has gradually followed the US in using due process to craft a privacy right that is used in all three of these areas, including the defense of some areas of sexual privacy. The court in Nas Foundation goes into the details of this gradual recognition of the privacy right. They then argue more briefly that Section 377 burdens this right, which they root in the word liberty in Article 21. As for dignity, the word life in Article 21 had long since been interpreted to mean life commensurate with human dignity, and the court gives this history as well. Then, by alluding to the factual record of stigma and discrimination, they argue that this right as well is burdened by Section 377. They mention that both the right to equality and the rights to privacy and dignity belong to all, just in virtue of their humanity. A compelling state interest must therefore be found, since the court has already disposed of the flimsy claim by the Home Office that Section 377 helps public health, which the Health Ministry had denied. The only remaining interest is supplied by popular sentiment. So the court now argues that a compelling governmental interest can never be supplied by a majority moralism that subordinates a class of persons. Popular morality, they note, is distinct from the morality embodied in the Constitution. And the Constitution makes the courts guardians of the fundamental rights, including and especially, quote, the fundamental rights of those who may dissent or deviate from the majoritarian view, end quote. At this point, the court quotes some well-known words of Dr. Ambedkar against majoritarianism. Thus, the court reminds its audience of the way in which the heinous practice of untouchability was held in place by majority sentiment. Now to disgust and stigma. The legal situation in Nas Foundation is thus somewhat different from that in the US cases in which animus played a leading role. In both Roma versus Evans and Lawrence versus Texas, the appeal to negative emotion was used to show that the laws in question lacked even a rational basis. As we've seen, that's what the court did with the notion of disgust in its Article 14 argument. But as to Article 21, given that strict scrutiny has been held to be the appropriate level of review, the legal role of disgust could be expected to be less prominent. All the court needs to do is to knock down each claim of compelling state interest. However, given that the claim of public morality is the central such claim, showing that the interest in criminalizing consensual gay sex is actually motivated by disgust and stigma, helps to establish the constitutional unsuitability of that interest in a nation committed to inclusiveness and equality. At the same time, it helps show precisely how the dignity of a minority has been violated, a key part of showing that Section 377 violates Article 21. For both of these reasons, and perhaps just understanding the importance of this issue, the court devotes quite a lot of attention to disgust and revulsion as putative justifications for maintaining the law. The term animus is used once in the opinion, but disgust, revulsion, and repugnance are used frequently. Now, I've already mentioned the court's indirect allusion to the caste hierarchy through its attention to Dr. Ambedkar's criticism of public sentiment. One of the most interesting sections of the opinion is a very explicit reference to caste in the form of a discussion of India's Hidras, a group targeted by public disgust and revulsion and treated at times as untouchable. No brief account can do justice to the complexity of this community, but over simply, Hidras are a very ancient community of transgender people, most of them male at birth, who identify as neither male nor female, and who often take a receptive role in sex with men, often dressing in female dress. They're already mentioned in the Kama Sutra, and it appears that in ancient Indian traditions, they were respected and not found disgusting. They're blessed by Rama in the Ramayana and given special functions at occasions such as childbirths and weddings. Now, however, forced by public stigma to live on the margins of society, Hidras are subject in an extreme form to harassment and violence, to denials of employment, and also to refusals of medical treatment. Almost 30% are HIV positive. The court discusses the history of this community, noting that the British displayed obsessive hostility to this group and even defined it for a time criminal tribe, that is, as people who are outlaws by their very nature. In 1871, that was done. Indeed, the persecution of this community was entirely British in origin. The court then reports that although Nehru called this stigmatization monstrous in 1936, the classification as criminal was not repealed until much later, and contemporary studies show that its ill effects have barely abated at all, as police feel free to mistreat members of this group and even torture them. Now, of course, Hidras are not the topic of Section 377, which sweeps much more broadly, but the court's intention is clear. This case, which most Indians they expect will agree to be monstrous for the way in which human beings are singled out by public disgust and then subjected to extreme forms of violence and discrimination, is really the situation of MSM in India much more generally. It just is the same case. There's ultimately no difference but one of degree. Section 377, in effect, classifies all MSM as a criminal tribe. That's what the court clearly wants the reader to see. The court thus makes disgust and untouchability, or quasi-untouchability, central in its analysis, showing the depth of tension between Section 377 and the spirit of the Indian democracy with its commitments to equality, dignity, and inclusiveness. The court then summarizes, if there's one constitutional tenet that can be said to be the underlying theme of the Indian Constitution, it is that of inclusiveness. This court believes that the Indian Constitution reflects this value deeply ingrained in Indian society, nurtured over several generations. The inclusiveness that Indian society traditionally displayed, literally in every aspect of life, is manifest in recognizing a role in society for everyone. Those perceived by the majority as deviants or different are not on that score excluded or ostracized. Where society can display inclusiveness and understanding, such persons can be assured of a life of dignity and non-discrimination. This was the spirit behind the resolution of which Nehru spoke so passionately. In our view, Indian constitutional law does not permit the statutory criminal law to be held captive by the popular misconceptions of who the LGBTs are. It cannot be forgotten that discrimination is antithesis of equality and that it is the recognition of equality which will foster the dignity of every individual. So, in short, using disgust, public disgust, as a way of pillorying and burdening individuals was the way of empire. India has a different set of commitments and a different history. This, I believe, is the deep insight Maas Foundation offers to the United States and other nations. Rationalize, animus, however you will, laws discriminating against gays and lesbians express a fear of contamination whose infamous prototype and core example is untouchability, and whose damages to equal dignity are profound. If we think the practice of untouchability is heinous, and a United States reader would quickly add the practices of our Jim Crow era regarding drinking fountains, swimming pools, lunch counters, and so on, and of course, interracial sexual relations, then we should think the same thing about our laws and practices where they discriminate on grounds of sexual orientation. We are not, however, at the end of the road. I must now turn to a recent development, the reversal of the Delhi High Court by the Indian Supreme Court. On December 11, 2013, the Supreme Court of India reinstated Section 377 in the case of Suresh Kumar Kushal versus Maas Foundation. The Attorney General had refused to appeal, and the central government later filed a review petition against the Supreme Court judgment, arguing that their reasoning was full of errors. The appeal was therefore filed by a man named Suresh Kumar Kushal, a private individual who runs an astrology center in Delhi. The case was heard by a two-judge panel, as is the norm. Thus, the judgment can't be taken to represent the view of the court as a whole, but of course that's not true for any judgment heard by a panel. There's no provision for en banc rehearing. However, there's a corrective mechanism known as a curative petition, and the Maas Foundation and the Lawyers Collective filed such a petition on March 31st, 2014, asking for an oral hearing of the petition and an interim stay on the Kushal decision. It has been admitted for hearing, but the matter is still pending. The Kushal opinion is also very long, but at that point, all resemblance to the Delhi opinion ceases. In terms of history, it bizarrely cites statements by Macaulay and other Victorian legal authorities as if they were 100% suitable for an independent India, not even addressing the historical contentions of the Delhi court. As to facts, the major reason given for reversing is that the Delhi court erred in its findings of fact. Now, to overrule a lower court on findings of fact is highly unusual and typically occurs only when the lower court's factual findings have been egregious. And yet, the Supreme Court simply asserts with no argument at all that the factual record concerning HIV/AIDS and the other issues is deficient. As we saw, that record was very detailed and very well corroborated, and from recognized authorities, including, of course, the National AIDS Commission and the Ministry of Health, with no factual evidence on the other side. Moreover, the Supreme Court itself extensively cites from Anand Grover's amicus brief, apparently granting him the status of a reliable authority. No discussion of violence against the gay minority is even offered. As for law, there's almost nothing there. First, there's an obvious standing issue that's not addressed at all. The case is structurally similar to the US case Hollingsworth versus Perry, where appeal of the same-sex marriage decision was brought by private individuals because the state of California refused to appeal. It should clearly have had a similar outcome, denying standing to the plaintiff, since the plaintiff had not suffered a legally cognizable harm. But this extremely important issue is not discussed at all. The key contention of the Delhi High Court, that majority preferences cannot trump fundamental rights, receives no reply at all. Indeed, the sloppiness of the entire text gives an impression of haste. What happened? Well, of course, the practice of hearing Supreme Court cases in panels of two or three with total 28 justices does mean that there's a certain amount of unpredictability in the procedure, but that practice is in many ways defensible on grounds that the court can't hear as many cases brought by petition as it wants to hear unless it hears cases in that way. So it's just not clear how it got that way one way or the other. These two justices simply did not do their job, and the opinion does not compel respect. As mentioned, the central government filed a petition against it, Many influential intellectuals and artists have protested the ruling. So have prominent world leaders, including U.S. Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. And yet, it remains law. If things are to change, either the curative petition has to succeed, which is very unclear, or Parliament must act, and I think this is pretty unlikely, at least at present. One gleam of light can, however, be found. In the wake of the 2013 judgment, violence against the Hijra community dramatically increased, including violence by the police. It was reported as well that the police were refusing to investigate reported instances of such violence. In a landmark ruling on April 15, 2014, in National Legal Services Authority versus Union of India, the Supreme Court ruled that Hijras and other transgender people should be treated legally as a third category, neither male nor female, and should also be entitled to affirmative action in education and employment. Nepal has recently ruled in a similar way. The case was heard by two justices, neither of whom was involved in the reversal of Nas Foundation. They have a very different mindset, clearly, from their colleagues. The judgment opens with a stern and eloquent repudiation of disgust and stigma. Quote, "Seldom our society realizes or cares to realize the trauma, agony, and pain which the members of the transgender community undergo, nor appreciates the innate feelings of the members of the transgender community, especially those whose mind and body disown their biological sex. Our society often ridicules and abuses the transgender community, and in public places like railway stations, bus stands, schools, workplaces, malls, theaters, hospitals, they are sidelined and treated as untouchables, forgetting the fact that the moral failure lies in the society's unwillingness to contain or embrace different gender identities and expressions, a mindset which we have to change." End quote. Whether this inclusive and tolerant view will dominate, or instead the narrow, zealously Victorian mindset of the court that overruled the Nas Foundation case, is anyone's guess. I don't myself have a confident view. But to conclude, disgust is a powerful force in human life, and it creates tough obstacles to a politics of equal respect. I'm with de Gaulle and Walt Whitman. It would be a great thing if we could bring up all young people to be totally free of bodily disgust. It would improve relations with others, and especially the all-important relationship with oneself. But even more important is inhibiting projective disgust, a primary force underlying discrimination and subordination. If societies prove powerless to stop projective disgust entirely, however, since that would require a degree of control over religion and the family that most of us might reject, they can still refuse to listen to its voice when laws are made. The Delhi High Court has it right. Laws against same-sex conduct are forms, in effect, of a caste hierarchy that identifies a group as untouchable and stigmatizes them as criminals by nature. Such laws have no place in any nation that pursues equality before the law. This wise opinion, together with the recent opinion about the Hijras, can enlighten and guide people of all nations, even while those of us who love India must remain distressed by the defeat of such humane ideas in the recent climate of punitive Victorianism.
Thank you, Professor, for that insightful lecture, drawing from various social sciences and engaging examples. I'm sure it has left the audience with not just food for thought, but also a lot of questions. And therefore, I'd now request Honorable Mrs. Justice Ruma Pal, who shall be moderating the question answer session, to offer her insight and open the floor to questions. Thank you.
I was absolutely spellbound by this lecture. So I don't know, we have I think about half an hour before lunch.
Oh, yes. This is Vikramjeet Dey, I teach here. My question is with regard to the reference that you made to religion and the way religious leaders have looked upon the whole question of sexual orientation in Indian culture. You did mention Vineet Nonagar's book. My question to you is rather more historical, because I teach history here. How did the Hindu revivalist leaders of the 19th century and the early 20th century, not to mention any one of them, look upon the whole question of sexual orientation? Did they exhibit any kind of disgust to same-sex marriages or relationships?
Yeah, it's a great question. I wish I knew the answer. I think, in general, my impression is evasiveness. Ramon Roy made no statement about that, so far as I'm aware. So at least in terms of the Bengali Enlightenment, I mean, as we see, Tagore was funny because he certainly never made an explicit allusion to this. On the other hand, choosing the bowels as his central case, you know, he could have chosen all kinds of different examples of what the religion of love would be like. And so by choosing that example, and by asking K.M. Sen to append an essay on that topic, albeit a very reticent essay that doesn't mention same-sex conduct, he certainly suggests that his own inner thought was more tolerant. I think, you know, they were all at this point concerned that the stigmatization of India itself and Hinduism itself as bestial by the British was a terrible source of pain and stigma. And of course they were quite right to be upset by that. And I think that in many ways there was a kind of overreaction. There were different kinds of overreaction, but in any case, I think what I found is just a great deal of evasiveness and reticence. I mean, we don't even see Gandhi discussing this. Now, I think Lelieveld was totally wrong to say that Gandhi even he suggests he might have felt same-sex desire for Hermann Kallenbach because they shared a house together. I think that's totally unconvincing. Yeah, because whenever Gandhi felt sexual desire, he expressed self-loathing and contrition. And he did that about some particular women for whom he found himself feeling desire, but never about Kallenbach. So that is rubbish. But he certainly, that Oscar Wilde remark, you know, I think Gandhi thought all sexual acts that are not reproductive, there's something wrong with them. And so homosexual acts, I'm sure he was quite negative about. So I guess, I think, you know, this is something I'd like to see more good research on, but in general, I think the practice was just not the talk.
Thank you so much, Professor, for that brilliant lecture. My name is Shaman Banerjee, I'm from Jamshedpur University. My question is, in today's society, apart from the social-political influences that you have referenced in your lecture, what about the capitalistic tendencies that makes disgust sell with the various body image issues that people in general find today facing? How do you think that reinforces the problem of disgust and the effects it has on society as a whole?
Oh, I think that's a wonderful question. And I think it's a terrible thing that people are inspired to loathe their bodies by so many aspects of media culture. Of course, the treatment of weight is the particular source, and I mean, one could go on and on about stigmatization of people who are overweight or called overweight. But, you know, in a more general way, I think the women in particular have been sold this bill of goods that their bodies are fundamentally unacceptable, and so they have to constantly be, certainly in my culture and my academic, my age group and my culture, everyone's always having plastic surgery all the time because they can't accept their own bodies. And this is terrible. I wrote a recent short article about the process of having a colonoscopy, which of course is a required and beneficial health procedure for everyone. But it turns out that more and more people demand to be anesthetized during that procedure, which is actually not painful and where the anesthesia is actually pretty dangerous. But the reason seems to be because as people age, they get increasingly uncomfortable with the fluids and excretions of their own body. And so I've talked to doctors and nurses about this, and they say, you know, people just want to be knocked out. They don't want to face their own colon. Well, you know, I grew up in the generation which wrote the famous book, Our Bodies, Ourselves, about how women ought to overcome stigma by taking charge of our bodies. We ought to take charge of childbirth, not be knocked out, be happy with the blood and the mess and so on. And, you know, unfortunately, it's the same people who used to say that. You know, then as they age, they think, oh, our bodies are terribly unacceptable. And I think that's, it's a central problem. It's a problem, I think, for everyone, but it's a particular problem for people who are aging, and maybe particularly even more for women who are aging. And yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about that a lot.
Sexual violence, the reason why this is used so much is because it has the ability to mobilize. And wouldn't it weaken certain other movements if you renounced it altogether instead of sort of a qualified renunciation?
Yeah, well, this is, I know that's vegetarianism. It's very complicated, I think, because the very good psychologists who did research on disgust thought that if you have aversion to eating animal flesh, that was a sign that you had a high level of disgust. But they didn't understand, of course, that you might have a completely undisgusted moral objection, an objection based on compassion and humanity toward the animals, and not a disgust reaction at all. Now, of course, as you become, as I have been for some time, vegetarian, you know, and you get less used to eating meat, then you might end up being pretty disgusted by it, and I sometimes find that I am, but I think that's only a byproduct, and the motivation has nothing to do with that. So I wouldn't like to argue for vegetarianism by saying meat is disgusting. I'd much rather focus on the suffering of the animal and the need of the animal for a flourishing life. I hope that answers the question. I mean, we've already learned that you can teach children toilet training without disgust. Parents no longer say, oh, this is disgusting. They instead just in a calm and loving way teach them that it's a better practice, that it's cleaner and so on, to use the toilet. And I think we can do that, and I think that's what we should do. Oh, Jen. But I don't see how she's connecting gender violence with disgust. It might be. I mean, misogyny is often bound up with disgust, but I'm not sure gender violence is particularly bound up with disgust as opposed to just a general desire for power.
So basically what I was referring to is the cruelty that is a part of the sort of meat industry as opposed to just meat itself being disgusting, or the cruelty that's a part of gender violence.
Well, I think sometimes you do see that. When I looked at the pamphlet literature that was circulated prior to the Gujarat riots, where the Muslim woman's body was indeed portrayed in a way apt to elicit disgust, I did feel that in that case there was a pretty strong connection between the nature of the violence, which often involved torture and so on, and disgust. So yeah, it can certainly be there. What I see in my own country, where there's this epidemic of gender violence on university campuses, I guess I don't think disgust is very much involved, because these are, you know, young women who are not found particularly disgusting who are being raped in these fraternity parties. It's more about power and about the desire to establish that young men face no limits to their conduct and they'll rule the world. It's often, and you know, I've also worked on cyberbullying, and I think there we find that it's often about fear of women's power. So it's feminist websites that are insulted and targeted for bullying. It's things like female law students who are targeted. There was this one particular website that targeted named female law students by attaching pornographic narratives to their names. And it was clear, once the people were unmasked, that they were unsuccessful male law students who resented the power of increasing power of women in society. So I think that doesn't have a whole lot to do with disgust. So I think you just have to look at each case and ask that question.
Since you mentioned fear on your last question, Oh, sorry. My name is Swati. I'm an LLM student here. So what I was wondering was that historically the reason behind things, behind these social modes and law would have been discussed, but over years, whether it has now turned to fear, and fear not for all kinds of sexuality. Typical male sexuality is seen as often used as an excuse for apologizing a lot of male behavior and is seen as normal. But anything other than typical straight male sexuality, whether female sexuality or alternate sexuality, is considered not only disgusting but threatening, not just at a social level, but even based on my personal experiences and observations, that if as a woman you claim authority over your own sexuality, the reaction from typical male, macho, virile person would be fear, which often manifests into violent, oppressive, and even, you know, condescending behavior. So I think it's more than just disgust. Over years, it's now become fear which rules these moves.
Well, thank you for that. I think, I think all of these issues require a lot more comparative study, comparative meaning comparing the different forms of stigma and prejudice. And actually, Zoya Hassan and I are planning a conference on this just now, so I hope we'll learn a lot more. I think fear and disgust are often closely linked, but the relationship is different in the different cases. So I think in the disgust that people felt for African Americans in the US South, fear was a very large component, because African Americans were brought to the US because their bodies were powerful. They were brought to do powerful slave labor, and then it was those powerful bodies, which of course were still powerful despite the abuse they suffered, that inspired fear of rape and riots and so on. And that is still the case. And I think, by the way, that Obama could never have been elected president had he been a traditional African American rather than a son of an African father and a white mother who was very skinny and unthreatening looking as he is. So, you know, I think that their fear was a very large component. Discrimination against the hijras, is anyone afraid of hijras? I think not. You know, so it's not such a big issue there, but there's more the stigma of the body, and that something makes you look at the sexual aspects of the body and draws attention to them in a way that's very uncomfortable for many people. So I think it's all varies. And with disgust toward women's bodies, I think, as I just said to the last questioner, sometimes it is connected to fears. In the case of these male law students who created these disgust-laden stories about the law students because they were afraid of them taking the places in law schools that they thought belonged to them. And but in other cases, it's really not so closely connected to fear. So I think we need to really look at these connections and understand them better than we do.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, my name is Prerna. I'm from Duke University, North Carolina, and I was working with the National Center for Lesbian Rights, Washington, D.C. I have a quick question for you, and that is, how do you think the human rights activists and the civil society in India could fight the feelings of disgust outside courts, considering that the real fight for LGBT rights is with societal morality?
Well, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think that's a question that Indians have to answer more than me. But I can tell you what's worked and not worked in the U.S. What they find, I mean, all these cases typically were the plaintiffs were some long-established couple. So the first thing they did was to try to get rid of the idea that gays are rampantly promiscuous and they threaten the family by foregrounding committed relationships. And that was objected to in some circles as whitewashing, but I think, you know, in the end, they want to win the case, and so they did. But even that, in terms of polls of public opinion, prior to the vote on Proposition 8, they found that the commercials that showed, let's say, two lesbian women holding hands did not reassure people. But what did reassure them was parents who come and say, you know, my daughter is a lesbian, but I would like her to be treated equally like anyone else. And the involvement of
straight parents who are very easy for the average person to identify with. They don't have to overcome any obstacle, and they all understand what it is to have a child that you love and to have that child suffer unjustified discrimination. The involvement of parents, I think, has been extremely important. So I would say that must be a good strategy among others that you could try.
Absolutely amazing lecture. My question is on the second half of your lecture, which is how do you look at the two judgments? One is sort of re-emphasizing on criminalization of homosexuality, and then the Nansa judgment. And what evaluation do you make of the Indian state and the Indian judiciary? And they came in such close proximity, and they go in opposite directions. Or do we look at hijras as capable of getting our sympathy, if not empathy, but the gays are more threatening? I mean, are we also distinguishing amongst the queer groups? So,
well, I don't think that, because the of course the Nas Foundation case itself made hijras central, and that was being repudiated by the Supreme Court. So I think the two Supreme Court opinions are really at loggerheads with each other. And the second, the Hijra opinion, is pretty clearly, I think, repudiating the mindset, as they use the word mindset, of the first. But, you know, I'm actually just writing a new paper now for a conference we're having at the end of April on implementing constitutional rights. That's a comparative project. And I'm talking about this whole issue of the panels of the Supreme Court, because I think it's, on the one hand, it's a great process if you want the court to be more inclusive and to hear more cases. So there has to be some way of dividing up the workload if you're really going to do that and have the right to be heard by petition, which of course the United States doesn't have. But it brings its costs, because you've got a degree of randomness in the process. And you have no way of dealing with it except by the curative petition, which is a very extraordinary measure. So I think that you just see the costs of what's an otherwise admirable system. I don't know. I mean, maybe Justice Powell would know much more. If the court had sat en banc in the case, what would have happened then? I don't know, really. But one can see that the internal differences, if you can imagine the U.S. Supreme Court hearing things where sometimes you get Scalia and Thomas hearing something, and another time you would have Justice Ginsburg and Justice Breyer. Well, it would be full of uncertainty and indeterminacy. Of course, it is even now when the court sits en banc, because we have the swing vote being Justice Kennedy. He himself is of so many minds that nothing is predictable. So I don't know. You know, I think it's just something for people interested in constitutional structure to ponder. And unfortunately, I'm sorry that the donor isn't here, because I was reading about his work on judicial reform and his proposal that there be this intermediate step of high courts who would sit to hear certain kinds of appeals and therefore reduce the workload. I'd like to ask the justices who are here to comment. I mean, do you have views about the panel system, or any ways in which workload could be dealt with that would produce greater consistency and uniformity?
At present, the Supreme Court speaks with many voices. We say the Supreme Court has held, you know, you has said X, Y, or Z, and it might just be two judges. Ideally, if we sat en banc, that would really represent the views of the Supreme Court. But as because of the workload, we have to sit separately. The number of judges have gone up, which means more voices. It's a sort of tortuous method by which I strongly suspect that the curative petition might be heard by a larger bench, because you have on the one hand the Kushal judgment, and the on the other hand the recent the later judgment on the Hijra. So it may be heard by a larger bench, in which case perhaps that would be more representative of the Supreme Court's views. You have another question.
My name is Zainab, and I'm an LLM student here. My question is that in India, there are many laws, legislations that are arguably rejected by the society. So you have a lot of social legislation, but there are certain sections of society that just don't follow them. And it's not exactly an implementation problem, but it's just a will of some kind that people don't want to follow these laws. So my question is that what happens if, say, there are amendments to the effect that same-sex marriages are legalized, but the disgust and the repulsion continues to prevail, nevertheless?
Yeah, well, of course, this is often the case with any period of social change. I think what you definitely need, among other things, now, of course, education can play a very important role in making young children believe that these groups are fully equal, and in the case of sexual orientation, there's no doubt that the fact that in high schools young people are coming out to their peers is a big factor in the change on social attitudes in the U.S., where now a vast majority of people under the age of 40 think same-sex marriage is okay. That's one thing, but another thing is, what are the police doing, and who are they? Now, I was very cheered to hear about the reservation of 30% for women in the recent in Delhi police that's just been adopted. I think that's a big step. But, of course, we want not just women, but the more important thing is people with certain training and certain attitudes who might be either male or female, because women can have the bad social attitudes too. So when Bratton was the commissioner of police in Los Angeles, he wanted a more feminine police force to deal with these issues, but not necessarily, he didn't think just by plugging in a certain number of women you could do it, but it was a matter of reforming police training to promote empathy and inclusive understanding, and of course forming specialized groups like people dealing with crimes of a sexual nature would be specialists in that. So I think by now, at least in the treatment of women who are raped, there's been a tremendous revolution in the United States in the behavior of the police. When I was a student, a woman who was raped just might as well not go to the police because they would be raped again by the treatment, I mean, figuratively by the treatment at the hands of the police. So anyway, I think in India, very important that reform of police be a central part of the process, because otherwise you'll have nice, well-educated students thinking hijras are great, but the actual reality would be that they're still subject to violence and police torture.
This is the last question. Last question.
Thank you, Professor, for this wonderful lecture. I'm Pragya, a PhD fellow in Calcutta University. My question is actually contrary to what Zaira asked. I wanted to know, how does one counter the over-deterministic philosophy that goes into the construction of this majority moralism? Because the popular representation and reception of homosexuality has definitely changed over the years. And in the way in which it is addressed in, say, the regional mainstream cinema. And how does one counter it in the context of the increasing institutionalization of the academic discourse on homosexuality through the inclusion of, say, new gender studies courses in the academic curriculum in Indian universities? How
well,
do we do that?
I think, you know, each society has to think, what are the best entry points? Now, as far as same-sex issues in the U.S. are concerned, I think there were two points of entry, as it were, the one being the young people themselves being willing to come out to their peers and their families supporting them, had a tremendous influence, because then people see, look, these are not monsters, these are not the bogeymen I've read about. And so now, even among evangelical Christians, a vast majority think same-sex marriage is fine, because they know the people and they just see that they're really like them. But the other crucial point of entry was the arts and cinema, because in every community of artists, and I'm sure this is true in India too, although not as openly, there's a large proportion of gay and lesbian people. There are in any group, but I think particularly in Hollywood, it was always known that there were many gays and lesbians there, but they didn't dare to speak. And at a certain point, they took the decision to speak and to create images for the public. And I would say there's no single thing
that's produced more changes of attitude than the television show Will and Grace. I don't know if anyone here has seen that, but those who have been in America, you probably have. It's a very funny situation comedy about a gay man who has as his roommate a straight woman, and they're both looking for love, but they find that the friendship between them is a very strong bond. But then he has a gay friend who's a different kind of gay man, who's more promiscuous and not really looking for love. So they were very careful to show variety, and then they show a lesbian woman who is herself bisexual and quite promiscuous. So they showed variety, but they did it with great humor and warmth and with a real sense of love and friendship, so that everyone found they could identify with these characters. And the actors who did that, who were both gay and straight, were really courageous in doing that. And I think that among other things, but many more things in Hollywood, are having a big influence. And until just now, in our latest Oscar broadcast, the Academy Awards for film, the host, Neil Patrick Harris, who has long been known to his acquaintances as a gay man, but he proudly proclaimed on national TV in this role of host of the Oscars, he was there with his husband, and he presented the husband, and they were wearing nice, fashionable attire, I mean, really, really cool clothes, and So it creates an image that's very positive and very winning. And I think that's really what has to happen. I don't know when Bollywood will be willing to do that. They were tuxedos, but they were bright color. And they had, a particularly good color sense, which men's tuxedos usually don't.
Thank you for coming, Justice Paul. And with that, we come to an end of the question and answer session. And we'd like to take this opportunity to felicitate Professor Martha Nussbaum, and I request Honorable Mr. Justice Altamush Kabir to kindly present her with a shawl as a token of our gratitude. And I'd also request Honorable Mrs. Justice Ruma Pal to present a memento as token of our gratitude to Professor Martha Nussbaum. It gives us great pleasure to be able to request Professor Nussbaum to kindly adjourn in volume 5. I now request Honorable Mr. Justice Altamush Kabir to kindly give the presidential remark.
Good afternoon, all of you, particularly those who are here on the dais, Justice Ruma Pal, Justice Taluddar, Mr. Bose, all those people who are here, very good afternoon to all of you. We've just heard a lovely lecture which did raise various questions and issues, and a lot of intelligent questions from the audience as well. I'll keep my presidential address to a very, very bare minimum. Let me just think of the two cases which were referred to. As far as the NAS Foundation case is concerned, that is something which is now, well, in the realm of not exactly history, but things were said by the Delhi High Court which have been not accepted by the Supreme Court. But the second judgment which Professor Nussbaum referred to, that is the National Legal Services Authority case, this has a little history behind it. A little history in the sense that this was part of the transgender community's ambitions, aspirations, which in fact we tried to channelize when I was there in the Supreme Court, and it started in Madras. In Madras, what is Chennai, we had a conference of these people, transgenders, who are often referred to as Hijras, sometimes as Kinnors, depending on the place where they are. And believe me, that was the first time that people started realizing that these people who had been marginalized were really people who had all kinds of talent. Unfortunately, amongst them, one person I remember who was a doctor, became a doctor, but she couldn't work in a hospital because she couldn't work in the ward where males were because she had a different kind of orientation. She ultimately had to set up a separate clinic. She left the job in the hospital and set up a sports clinic center instead. There was a person there, a transgender, who performed the Bharatanatyam so beautifully. You can't just imagine how graceful she was. And it just showed the talent that this community had or has. Then we had another conference in Delhi, in Bangalore. In fact, in Karnataka, there were four sessions. And the session in Karnataka, which was the last, at that point of time, the present Chief Justice here in Calcutta, Manjula Chidur, she was in Karnataka and she had taken a large amount of responsibility in holding these various conferences. And the Bangalore one was so beautiful, I just can't tell you. There were more than 250 delegates of the transgender community. And we also had the privilege of giving a transgender person who had studied up to class 4 an employment in the Karnataka High Court. This is something which we started because we felt that this group which had been marginalized, they needed support and they needed support of society. There should not be, as is the topic today, there should not be any kind of disgust as far as they were concerned. Disgust is something which comes to people as and when they feel that things are being portrayed which are not what is normal to them. If they find something which is different, there may be a sense of disgust. Alright? The basic argument against the LGBT movement is that God created man and women mainly for the purpose of procreation. That is why there are two different sexes. But at the same time, the fact that people could have different sexual orientations, that is something which people don't or didn't really take into consideration. What was beautifully described in the Madras conference is that a transgender, he cannot help his own or her own sexuality. It could be either male, could be either female. That means a person, maybe a woman in a man's body. That is the way it was sought to be described, that a transgender is a person, basically mainly women, who are entrapped in male bodies in spite of the fact that their genes or their entire orientation is that of a woman. The disgust element comes in only when you think that this is something which is out of the ordinary. If you didn't have that, there wouldn't be a sense of disgust at all. Today, these people are marginalized. Just look at the way, what can these disciplines do? They are not provided with jobs. People hesitate to employ them, but they also have to eat. What do? The next best is prostitution. That is why you have a lot of this kind of people all over the place, and they live in ghetto-like communities where they all get together and they feel for themselves alone. They know that society has not really accepted them. But a great effort has been made. Madras, the government, has formed or constituted a board, especially a board for transgender women. And I understand that they're also getting a pension of about 1,000 rupees or so per month. This has also caught on in Bangalore and in Delhi as well. So now these people are no longer people who are absolutely marginalized by society. The people, why did they get feel a little disgust as far as these people were concerned? They came down begging. They came down because that was the only thing they could do. They came around at marriages, at different functions, and tried to force themselves on the people there, asking for money. That was the only way they could earn something. That is as far as these people are concerned. But if we look at the two cases that are there in the Supreme Court, was there in the Delhi High Court and then the other one in the Supreme Court did take care of this. As far as a curative petition is concerned, this is something which is not really any particular jurisdiction as such, except that this is a jurisdiction where the Supreme Court assumes jurisdiction under Article 142 of the Constitution. It's not something which is there under the rules. How far it will go, one doesn't know. But I can say one thing. As far as I am concerned, I know that this is possibly not the end. Just like Justice Pyle just now mentioned, that a matter which comes by way of a curative petition, it has to be heard by a bench of 5 judges. According to the Supreme Court rules, that is what is done. Yes, if there is something which that particular bench of 5 judges feels needs to be heard by a larger bench of judges, they can always defer it. This has happened and this can take place. So something may not be absolutely final. Things may change as mindsets change. I wouldn't really like to comment on the two sets of judges. One which decided the case of the Nas Foundation case and the other one which has decided this or passed orders in the National Legal Service Authority's case. It was a case which was taken up as a cause by the National Legal Service Authority, which under Section 4 of the Act has the right, or is rather mandated, to take up social issues like this and file social interest litigations. Not bills, but SILs. Social justice litigations. And this is what NALSA did. At a point of time, when, in fact, I was there in Delhi, when they came out with this petition with regard to transgenders, and various orders have now been passed. Anyway, I don't think there is anything really required to be said after Professor Nozomi has done. She said it all. Whatever I have to be said, she said it all. But there's one aspect of Professor Nozomi's thinking which many of you may have just had a little glimpse here and there, and that is, she's an animal lover. She's a person who has written a book along with somebody else as a co-author on the rights of animals. Taking everything together, the personality that she has or that she portrays, from what I've read about her and from what I've seen of her books, it's one thing that really was not really touched upon today because it was not part of the the topic as such, that was the book that she has written, a very, very, a book which is, which has been acclaimed by many, and maybe there are a few who have not liked the contents, let's put it that way, and that is the book called The Clash Within. I don't know whether you all have seen that book or read that book, but it has little overtones of Samuel Huntington's Clash of Civilizations. You will find there the analysis that she's made of certain situations here in India, and her being in Delhi with JNU and being here in India, a long association, has helped her to bring out certain things which may at first glimpse may seem to be a little revolutionary, but at the same time, if you look deeper, you'll find that it makes a lot of sense. I am extremely glad that the Vice Chancellor requested me and invited me to be here to listen to her and to listen to the questions that were put forth by the students here. And I can tell you this much, our girl students here are, they take the lead in many of the things which happen. I've seen them in the classes, and I see that they are much more forthright than their male compatriots. The lady who is doing the comparing here is one of my favorite students. And well, all in all, it was a lovely occasion and a very, very nice sort of a way to spend the morning. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I now request Ms. Ruchira Goswami, Assistant Professor of Sociology, NUJS, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Shushruti. It gives me immense pleasure, and it is indeed my deep honor to give this vote of thanks and to give this vote of thanks to Professor Martha Nussbaum, a name we grew up with as students of sociology. Her works inspired us. I mean, she was like Martha Nussbaum. And to see her here in person today and to have a brief exchange with her and to listen to this fantastic, really all-encompassing lecture, I mean, we were all spellbound. I did look around the auditorium, and like most people, as Justice Pal said, had their mouths a little half open, if not, and they were like, okay. So it was absolutely amazing. It's enriched all of us here. Thank you so much, Professor, for this fantastic, fantastic lecture. This lecture wouldn't have been possible if Sri Venugopal wasn't here. He's not with us here in person, but I know he's here with us, and thanks to Sri Venugopal for his little write-up that he sent us. And it is because of his continuous efforts that we've been able to host the third Nambia lecture. So thanks to Sri Venugopal. Justice Ruma Pal and Justice Kabir have, I don't know if we can thank them enough. They have been through us since the beginning, through thick and thin, at all moments of pride, at all moments of when we had problems, and they've been the forerunners of the struggle for legal and social equality, standing by the marginalized and the vulnerable all the times, standing with us here today. This lecture would have been incomplete without the presence of Justice Kabir and Justice Pal. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for being with us. And finally, the Vice Chancellor of this university, Professor Ishwar Bhatt, had taken absolutely personal effort to see that this lecture is done well, as for all lectures, to the point of personally looking into the nitty-gritty of the program, to getting into mundane details, which he could have easily left it to anyone, but he had taken a personal interest to see that everything is in place, not only just to host Professor Nussbaum, but all the little details that go into hosting a lecture. And he's been the continuous inspiration to get this lecture and several other lectures and several other events that are held here in NHS. Thank you so much, sir, for standing by us. I also want to thank all the guests who have come from outside. I'm sorry if I'm missing anybody's name in particular, but I see my professor, the one who introduced me to the works like Nussbaum and others, Professor Prashanta Roy, the Professor Emeritus of Presidency University and a professor at the IDSK here with us. Thank you so much, sir, for coming and gracing the occasion. We also have Professor Ahmed, who again has been with us right since the beginning, Professor I.J. Ahmed, Professor of Law at the Department of Law at Calcutta University. Thank you so much, sir, for coming here. We have Justice, Honorable Justice Amit Talukdar. We have Professor Shuja Basu. Again, people who are a part and parcel of NUJS, again, standing through us in thick and thin. And they have come and participated in nearly all such programs, keeping away, even if they had a lot of work, they would stay back. I remember both of them. We just had a conference last week, the Ashutosh Mukherjee conference, and they were there supporting us throughout the 2 days of the conference when the crowd was really going bleak. Justice Talukdar really said, can't you call some of your students to join us? And he takes a personal interest, Professor Bas and Justice Talukdar. Thank you so much, sir. The last but not the least, and it is only possible by students of the Human Rights Diploma course are here with us. And the students, of course, need thanks for several things. But in this occasion, I think they need a great hand. And Professor Nussbaum noted it, that it's day after tomorrow that we have the exam starting. And thank you for putting all our suspicions and proving us wrong. It was only the Vice Chancellor who said we will have it on the 23rd. Nearly the entire faculty said, you can't do it in the auditorium, you will just find 5 people. And there were some of us who were saying, even with Nussbaum? And some of us were skeptics, some of us are diehard optimists that Nussbaum at the hall is going to be full. And a whole lot of things happened about your presence here. And thank you for proving several of us, the skeptics in the faculty, wrong, and proving the Vice Chancellor right. And thank you, and making it here. A big thanks to all of you. A big thank you to all the guests, all the students, all fellows, whoever has come in from other places at a short notice. If you put us on your, if you send us your details, we promise to put you on our mailing list so that you get all such events, all such invites for exciting events. We will draw this session to a close, but we will have another session with Professor Nussbaum at 2:15 in 107, in room number 107, that's on the first floor. And she'd be discussing, this is going to be a much more open session, on law and emotion, and as the VC said in the morning, on law and anger, and also her one of the most well-known works that most of us have studied at some point of time in the career, on the capabilities approach, and this very, very new area of work that is emerging in law and affect. So you're all welcome. See you all around at 2:15 in room 107. Thank you all very, very much. Thanks to all our dignitaries on the dais, and a great hand to Professor Nussbaum. Thank you so much for coming.